Okay, Suyash. So can you tell me a little about your professional background?
All right. I have right now about 9 months of experience. I work at Samsung R&D Bangalore, and I work in the camera systems team. I'm a software engineer basically, and I work to support the cameras for new mobiles. And the reason I wanted to give the GMAT was because I want to do an MBA, because I want to go into product management. So right now what I do is closer to writing software, and I want to go into a field in which I can I can focus upon what new mobiles to create, which all cameras it should have, how many cameras it should have. Basically, I want to understand the market, what it requires, and create products, think about what the product is going to be, and leave the development of it to engineers, basically.
Okay.
That was my goal, and that's why I wanted to give the GMAT.
Okay, so you're looking to do your MBA, is it?
Yes.
Right, so are you looking to do it sometime this year or next year?
No. So this was a long-term plan.
Okay.
I plan to do an MBA about 3-4 years from now.
Okay, got it. So when did you decide to write the GMAT? Like, which month?
I joined my company in August, and I'd been thinking about product management for a while, so I thought that I should get done with GMAT as soon as possible. I think mid-September, I decided that I should start preparing for GMAT, and I wanted to give it around December, January.
Okay, so around 4 months.
Yeah, I properly started studying for it around in October.
Okay.
And I gave it in December.
Okay, fine. So how did you you always have that initial research phase, right? Where you have to find out about, okay, what is the GMAT? What are the essential things I have to know? And all that research that goes on. So how did you go about it?
I started with typically what a profile for a product manager should be like. What is there in the world currently? And I realized that I did a 6 month internship before this. That was at Zynga Games, and I interacted with several product managers there. And I even tried to get a job as a product manager there, but they said that they typically hire only MBAs. So that's when I first thought about getting an MBA, and I realized that if I really want to be someone influential in the tech field, I think I should get an international MBA. So that's why I decided to go for GMAT and not CAT. Then I started to do research about it, and I thought that maybe getting some coaching for GMAT would be good. I was already comfortable with the quant part. Maths and all was good for me. I thought that maybe some guidance in with the verbal part would be good.
Okay, so how did you hear about CrackVerbal?
So basically, my company is around Outer Ring Road in Bangalore, and I tried to search for good coaching institute that's very nearby to my home, and I found CrackVerbal, that the center in Marathali. I used to wake up early, some 6-7 a.m., get 1 hour of study done, practice some questions and all. Then later I would go to office and try to find some time around lunch or some time in the evening to just go through my materials and do some more questions. So I think on an average, I used to do some 1.5 hours, 2 hours of study on weekdays. And weekends, I did not really study on weekends much. So it was more of a weekday thing. On weekends, I used to go to the classes, and I thought that was enough.
Okay. And what was your GMAT experience like? So the day you wrote the test, do you want to talk about that?
So the thing is, the pattern changed in 2018, I think. So there was a little bit of a difference in time management in both quant and verbal. And I practiced all of them with the older pattern. So I'd been getting really good marks in the mock test. I had gotten used to that kind of mock test. So when I actually gave the GMAT, I think I somehow lacked in time management in quant. What happened was in the last few questions, I had run out of time. So I had to guess the last few questions. And as you know, in GMAT, guessing would really bring your score down.
Right.
So what happened was, my quant got affected a little, and because mentally, I had this pressure that I've screwed up quant, I think, a little. I've guessed the last few questions. So mentally, I was not very stable during the break in between. And actually, what happened was we get some, I think, 6 minutes of break in between. I went out, I chilled for some 2 minutes, then I thought that I'll go back and sit at my desk. And what happened was when I went to the desk, they immediately started my verbal exam. So I got effectively only 2 minutes of break. So at that moment, I was confused whether to be angry at that person, why did you start my test, or should I just focus on my verbal. So it was kind of like the end of my quant and the beginning of my verbal were both shaky. I think that affected my score a little. But around the second half of verbal, I managed to get back to it.
Okay, and you ended up scoring a 750, is it?
Yeah, but I was getting better marks in my mocks, and I wanted to get those marks only at the actual GMAT. So it is a pretty good score, but I'm slightly disappointed with the outcome.
I would say that's a great score, but despite, you know, considering what happened to you on the day of the test,
just say that you should really know what the test day would look like. So if you're not allowed to go back to the desk, you should know that beforehand.
Right, that's good.
And you should be accustomed to the new pattern. So I would say it's a little expensive getting the 6 test from the official website, but I would say go for it.
Okay.
It's better to be accustomed to the new pattern.
Okay, and is there anything else that you would want to advise future GMAT, you know, test takers?
Okay, for me, verbal has three parts, right? Reading comprehension, critical reasoning, and sentence correction.
Right.
So for me, according to my natural ability, I found critical reasoning the easiest and sentence correction the most difficult. So what I ended up doing was I spent most of my time with sentence correction. I went through all the rules again and again and again. All those idioms and all I used to read every day. So basically, I would say focus on your weaknesses and your strengths will take care of themselves. It's I would say give a diagnostic exam in the beginning, try to find out what your strengths and weaknesses are, and then proceed along according to that.
So did you take a diagnostic exam before starting your GMAT preparation?
Yes, I started coaching at CrackVerbal. Then at the very first weekend, I gave a diagnostic exam, and that was a little low score, but it told me where I need to work. So that was good. From there onwards, I completed my coaching at CrackVerbal. I did not give any mock tests in between. So I saved the remaining 5 exams for when I was actually going to give the GMAT. And in all of the 5 exams, I was consistently scoring the same score. So I thought that I'm ready now. I should go and give the GMAT.
Okay.
So I'd say giving a diagnostic exam really helps. And afterwards, it's more or less how you practice.
Awesome. Fine. So do you have any, I know you want to do your MBA, let's say 4 years from now, but do you have any particular university that's on your mind, some university that you want to definitely apply to?
See, because I want to pursue product management and I'm from an engineering background, I think that I need to build my profile in a marketing background now. So I'm targeting universities that are known for marketing. Some of them are Kellogg's University, Northwestern, Stanford and all is good. But I think that I need to really build a good profile before actually seriously applying to those universities. And I feel that maybe giving the GMAT again, pumping up my score would really help.
Okay, so you're planning to retake the GMAT?
It's not a definite criteria. I just think that if I have time in future, I can give it again. But even the score is good.
Okay.
I would just say be consistent with the studies, because in the beginning, a lot of it would not make sense. You would be making the same mistakes again and again. But keeping some kind of error log, I used to keep a notebook in which I used to note down each and every error that I made and why I made that error. And I used to go through those logs so that I would not make the same mistake again. So in the beginning, it seems rather hopeless. You feel that maybe you don't know the English grammar that well to do well in sentence correction or something like that. But I think practice really does make you perfect. So it's a matter of progression basically. You should focus upon what you're not good at and just keep practicing towards it.